People say your dreams are crazy. If they laugh at what you think you can do. Good. Stay that way. Because what non-believers fail to understand is that calling a dream crazy is not an insult. It's a compliment. Don't try to be the fastest runner in your school or the fastest in the world. Be the fastest ever. Don't picture yourself wearing OBJ's jersey. Picture OBJ wearing yours. Don't settle for homecoming queen or linebacker. Do both. Lose 120 pounds and become an Ironman after beating a brain tumor. Don't believe you have to be like anybody to be somebody. If you're born a refugee, don't let it stop you from playing soccer for the national team at age 16. Don't become the best basketball player on the planet. Be bigger than basketball. Believe in something, even if it means sacrificing everything. When they talk about the greatest team in the history of the sport, make sure it's your team. If you have only one hand, don't just watch football. Play at the highest level. And if you're a girl from Compton, don't just become a tennis player. Become the greatest athlete ever. Yeah, that's more like it. So don't ask if your dreams are crazy. Ask if they're crazy enough.
From WBR in radio and on the Boston Red Network. The title of our episode, Monkey Business, The Inside Job. We're on the 6th of September 2018. There's been a series of recent revelations come out about the administration of DJ Trump. Omarosa's tell-all book came out there and hit the stands. She went on the talk show slash booksellers circuit. How much it had an effect on the body politic is very difficult to observe. These little items such as this appear and disappear, particularly in this administration. For those that were around for the Watergate ride, we had, of course, Deep Throat. The Washington Post and the New York Times coming out periodically every week or so with a new chapter in Watergate. But Watergate, you had numerous defendants there. You had a joint hearing of Congress. Sam Irving, was the ringmaster there. The late senator from South Carolina. I believe he was South Carolina. I always get those Carolinas mixed up. But nonetheless, I think he was. And you had John Dean there and various others. And you also had a character called Deep Throat. But in the Trump Gate operation, we'll call it, you have numerous people appearing. You have Bob Woodward's tell-all book that is coming out, over 400 pages. And excerpts from it have been appearing in the Washington Post. But for DJ Trump, this is September, the first week in September. Therefore, you don't get the full impact of it. But now the New York Times has come out with an anonymous type article, more of a Deep Throaty type thing, but they know who the person is. Whereas Deep Throat, there were years and years later that we found out he was a senior type within the FBI. But this particular saga is much, much different. You have a grand jury impaneled in Washington, D.C. You have a special prosecutor, Mueller, already there. You have the possibility he could be fired. D.J. Trump is threatened to fire Beauregard Sessions, the attorney general. And Nixon did, in fact, do that. What is different in this particular situation than in Watergate is the numerous media sources. You have social media, but not only social media. In Watergate, you did not have the proliferation of cable TV. You had ABC, NBC, and CBS primarily. CNN was to come later. So it is a sensational thing. People were watching those hearings live on in many, many settings. I remember on college campuses, they were at student centers watching the Watergate hearings. They were the talk of the town, and of course after they were adjourned, there was commentary on the nightly news or nightly commentary at night. The newspapers were full of it. It was syndicated throughout the country. And this is one thing to remember. The Washington Post also is syndicated throughout the country. And the New York Times. And, of course, then you have AP dispatches that are syndicated also. And for any nominal president, this Russian thing would have depressed his ratings. But in an increased, polarized climate, his ratings, and we'll look at those in a minute here, have basically stayed in the low 40s. The Independent Business Journal in their poll had him at 36. So he has been in the low 40s, or perhaps the mid 30s the last few days, depending on which poll you are looking at. What further complicates this situation, you have the Kavanaugh hearings, and we don't talk much about Kavanaugh here because we see Kavanaugh as nothing more than a party hack. A person that's an apologist, a right-wing type that is sneaking into the Supreme Court. Now, the responsibility here rests with the Republican Party, and progressives should be focused on the Republican Party. Forget about D.J. Trump. D.J. Trump will go up or he will go down with his popularity. If his popularity gets in the mid-30s, and consistently stays there, he's beginning to start to take on water. But according to our analysis, he has to get into the 20s before he's in danger and stay in the 20s. But it's the Republican Party. They are running this confirmation hearing in a very tenuous time. It should be adjourned for now and started back after the midterm elections. Now, what will be the fallout? Well, stay tuned on that one. Depends on what is coming out between now and Election Day in November. What we do know is, in many of those House districts that Hillary Clinton won, they're now becoming more and more contentious. You have a number of these, the House races, gubernatorial races, that are toss-ups. And it only takes a few hundred votes to move a toss-up to the column of the opposition. And even Ducey in Arizona, who appointed Kyle, and Kyle's nothing more, 76 years old, he's a lobbyist. Everyone knows it. And he has not even said if he will stay there for the full 2 years. He's there to give that vote to Kavanaugh. But those kinds of tricks, particularly in some districts, will not work. And we're talking about places like Missouri, where it's a toss-up there between McCaskill Hoxley, I believe, the Attorney General. Those are, and then we have a race between Smith and Housley in Minnesota. There are a number of those races that are toss-ups. And of course, we have the gubernatorial race in Florida. And that is why we entitle this Monkey Business. The right wing and several white supremacists have moved into that area. The robocalls, Republican candidate himself, DeSantis, has labeled Andrew Gillum a monkey. And that's an interesting situation. H was talking about that he'd called him a monkey, and also at the same time, the Monopoly media were terming this as Mr. Gillum, Hillary the Monster Clinton's boy, and Bernie Sanders' boy in Florida. That's not going to matter very much. But the whole idea of the literally of a monkey swinging through the trees in central Florida on his way to Tallahassee. And the polls, the preliminary polls, have Mr. Gillum in the margin of error. We at this mic expected that DeSantis would start out at least a few percentage points ahead. Now, it doesn't mean very much. We're in September as to how the polls will continue to be and where the momentum. But it does not help because DJ Trump has nationalized the 2008 midterm campaign. And he will be in Florida trying to hustle votes for DeSantis. Now, that in itself, DeSantis, I have to look at his name, but anyway, nonetheless, that is a very tenuous case at best. Yes, the Trump loyal supporters will vote for anything that DJ Trump serves up, including a ham sandwich. But in Florida, as the conservative commentator Willie Lawson said, it is a purple state, not a red state. Therefore, for DeSantis to win in Florida, he has to get a lot of Democrat and independent votes. Will he get those? It's up in the air at this point in time if he will or he won't. The other wild card, of course, is the government integrity investigation into some people in the Tallahassee, Florida municipal government there. But that hasn't been mentioned, and as we were looking at an article, I believe it was last night, that not much has been heard of DeSantis. Evidently, the Republican strategy is right now, he's got a war chest. There's no reason for him to be giving a lot of interviews at this point in time. Just let the ground game, the money that he has, hit the airwaves with as much negative ads as he can. But one of the big problems here, out of Washington, the negative information on DJ Trump is coming out daily. And that in itself does cause problems in the short term and the long term. Now, DJ Trump has answered that he could get reelected because of his accomplishments. What DJ Trump does not comprehend is those accomplishments, so-called accomplishments, tax cut, etc., were done in the early part of his administration. And when you get into the second half and go into lame duck land in your administration, some of your signature programs are all but forgotten. Period. And this is a big problem. And in Korea, well, the problem there is Chairman Kim has announced that he hopes to denuclearize the Korean Peninsula, along with Mr. Lee, his counterpart in the Republic of Korea, by 2021. Perhaps that will happen or not, and he still has the same opinion of DJ Trump. It doesn't matter. Chairman Kim is not a voter in the U.S. of what his opinion is, and this is getting to be also very dicey in terms of any types of agreements or future agreements that people have or expect to have in the next 2 years with DJ Trump. Will DJ Trump be there to execute these agreements, or will he be so underwater that he's completely ineffectual? Now, that is a very big question to ask. And at the same time, the Nike Corporation out of Beaverton, Oregon, has put up the Cullen Kopenick commercial. Very, very good commercial, almost 2 minutes long. It is the 30-year anniversary of Let's Do It, and numerous people are featured in the commercial, including Serena Williams, who is at the U.S. Open now. She came out of Compton, California. what Mr. Kopenick's talking about there is the whole idea of resistance and go as far as you can possibly go. You can dream, you can be looked at as a fool, but at the same time, achieve your goals. And that's what this thing, this whole commercial is about, is about progress. And whereas what comes out of DJ Trump's operation is negativity. How this affects the national landscape, we'll have to wait and see in the second week of November after that particular election. How it affects the House and even how it affects the Senate. Will there be significant pushback because of this Kavanaugh affair? Let's get to the documents here that we want to just look at from the New York Times. This is an opinion piece published on the 5th of September. I am part of the resistance inside the Trump administration. I work for the president, but like-minded colleagues, and I have avowed to follow parts of his agenda and his worst incriminations. The Times today has taken the rare step of publishing an anonymous op-ed essay. We have done this so at the request of the author, a senior official in the Trump administration whose identity is known to us, whose job would be jeopardized by its disclosure. We believe publishing this essay anonymously is the only way to deliver an important perspective to our readers. We invite you to submit your questions about the essay or our vetting process. President Trump is facing a test to his presidency unlike any faced by a modern American leader. It's not just a special prosecutor looms large, or that the country is bitterly divided over Mr. Trump's leadership, or even his party might well lose the House to an opposition hell-bent on his downfall. The dilemma, which he does not fully grasp, is that many senior officials in his administration are working diligently from within to frustrate parts of his agenda and his worst inclinations. I would know. I'm one of them. To be clear, ours is not the popular resistance of the left. We want the administration to concede and think that many of its policies have already made America safer and more prosperous. But we believe our first duty is to the country, and the president continues to act in a manner that is detrimental to the health of our republic. That says it all right there. This is why many Trump appointees have vowed to do what we can to preserve our democratic institutions while thawing Mr. Trump's more misguided impulses until he is out of office. The root of the problem is the president's amorality. Anyone who works with him knows that he is not cemented to any discernible first principles that guide his decision-making. He uses the word moored. Although he was elected as a Republican, the president shows little affinity for ideas long espoused by conservatives. Free minds, free markets, and free people. At best, he has invoked those ideas in scripted settings. At worst, he has attacked them outright. In addition to his mass marketing of the notion that the press is the enemy of the people, President Trump's impulses are generally anti-trade and anti-democratic. Don't get me wrong, there are bright spots that the near ceaseless negative coverage of the administration fails to capture. Effectively deregulation, historic tax reform, and a more robust military and more. But we would question the more robust military because you have to look at the value of the military in itself. The military is not a vehicle of production, with the exception to the military-industrial complex and those employed by it. It generates very little capital of itself. And yet it ties up precious capital that could be used in other places such as education, healthcare, and housing of our people. Meetings with him veers off a topic and off the rails. He engages in repetitive rants, and his impulsiveness results in half-baked, ill-formed, and occasionally reckless decisions that have to be walked back. There is literally no telling whether he might change his mind from one minute to the next. A top official complained to me recently, exacerbated by an Oval Office meeting, in which the president flip-flopped on a major decision he had made only a few weeks earlier. The erratic behavior would be more concerning if it weren't for the unsung heroes in and around the White House. Some of his aides have been cast as villains by the media, but in private they have gone to great lengths to keep their decisions contained to the West Wing, though they are clearly not always successful. It may be cold comfort in this chaotic area, but Americans should know that there are adults in the room. That's referring to the baby characterization of DJ Trump. We fully recognize what is happening, and we're trying to do what is right, even when DJ Trump won. The results is a two-track presidency. Now, this is very important here. Take foreign policy. In public and in private, the president shows a preference for autocratic and dictators such as V.I. Putin and Chairman Kim of the Democratic Republic of Korea, my words, not the words printed here, and displays little genuine appreciation for the ties that bind us to allies, like-minded nations. Astute observers have noticed through the rest of the administration is operating on another track, on one where countries like Russia are called out for meddling and punishing accordingly, and where allies around the world engaged as peers rather than as ridiculed as rivals. On Russia, for instance, the president is reluctant to expel so many of Putin's spies as punishment for poisoning of a former Russian spy in Britain. He complained for weeks about senior staff members letting him get boxed into a future confrontation with Russia, and he expressed frustration that the United States continued to impose sanctions on the country for malign behavior. But his national security team knew better, and such actions had to be taken to hold Moscow accountable. This isn't the work of a so-called deep state. It is the work of a steady state. Given the instability many have witnessed, there were early whispers within the cabinet of invoking the 25th Amendment, which would start a complex process of removing the president, but no one wanted to anticipate a constitutional crisis. And this is a deep conversation here that they were actually thinking of invoking the 25th Amendment. So, we will do what we can to steer the administration in the right direction until one way or the other it's over. The biggest concern is not what Trump has done to the presidency, but rather what we as a nation would allow him to do to us. We have sunk low with him and allowed our discourse to be stripped of civility. John McCain put it best in his farewell letter. All Americans should heed his words and break free of the tribalism trap with the high aims of uniting through our shared values and love of this great nation. We may no longer have Senator McCain, but we will always have his example for restoring honor to public life and our national dialogue. Trump may fear such honorable men, but we should revere them. There is a quiet resistance within the administration of people choosing to put the country first, but the real difference will be made by everyday citizens rising above politics, reaching across the aisle, and resolving to shed the labels in favor of one of a single one Americans. Now, this is the anonymous article, but in all due respects to the writer, the polarization that DJ Trump is now involved in, the Republican Party has invoked this for many, many years. Since the stolen election by G.W. Bush in 2000 and the re-election of G.W. Bush up to the time of the Depression and the election of Barack Obama in 2008, McConnell, who is the leader of the Senate, or was the minority leader at the time, forestalled as many of Barack Obama's programs as he could possibly do. And when he became the leader, he said his job was not to make or to let Barack Obama succeed. And he did that. We were able to pass the Affordable Care Act. The Republicans used that as a talking point against President Obama, along with the birth certificate rouge. And DJ Trump was a champion of the birther movement until it fell apart. He ended up in with college transcripts. But this is what has brought about to the current day. And we look back even at Senator McCain's campaign with Sarah Palin. They held those things on private property, parking lots, etc. And those were the venues where they had out there, hang him high, etc. He's not a citizen. The same type of rhetoric you see today at DJ Trump rallies. It didn't start with DJ Trump. So the problem here is not actually DJ Trump. It's the Republican Party. And the American people need to be focused on who those people are, what their policies is, and their attempt now to sneak this right-wing ring of Kavanaugh into the Supreme Court, which he could be there for years. So tough questions have to be asked, and tough votes have to be taken, and the people have to be informed in 100 to 200 words of what this man's record actually is and what he has written in the past, period. And those are what the commercial should be about. The Democrats in the Senate, because of various things, will not be able to stop Kavanaugh's confirmation moving to the Supreme Court. Kyle has come just in case. And then you have Democrats in vulnerable positions that if the Republicans have the votes, they have no choice but to vote for his confirmation. Such as Donnelly in Indiana. I don't know what Claire McCaskill will do. And then you have Heidi Heinekant in North Dakota. Those are some of those quote-unquote red states that Trump won by double digits, some of them. But that doesn't mean that necessarily that has to occur. Now take Texas, for instance, a state he won by less than 10 points. Very close race, getting closer every day, between Beto O'Rourke and lying Ted Cruz, period. Trump, no doubt, will not go to Texas very much because in Texas he can't help lying Ted very much there. And in states where he's appearing, particularly Republicans in these House districts, are very careful about having him there, particularly if his between now and mid-October, if his polling numbers goes down precipitously. Those will be problems that he will occur on him. And this anonymous letter going out is not good for him. In fact, it's more damaging than Woodward's book. But once Woodward's book is out, being almost 500 pages, he'll be on the circuit. It'll be on all channels, including Fox News. So in other words, people will hear about this. And this patriot, they like to use the word patriot, within the group of patriots within his own administration are working to fell some things, while they say, well, okay, there were some positive things there. So in other words, they're looking at it dialectically. But at the same time, he has Colin Kopenick on TV 24/7 as the voice of Let's Do It. And the people that buy the Nike sporting shoes are younger people, millennials, people of color, etc. And this is a worldwide situation. Be received well. In fact, his jersey is the fifth largest selling, this is Colin Kopenick, jersey, and he's not even in the NFL. This is not good for the NFL owners because they are, as they say, reinforcing this. If you look at a baseball team, a football team, you have the Nike Just Do It symbol. So in other words, what you have done is immortalized Colin Kopenick. Colin Kopenick's the voice, the symbol is there, and you can go to various sporting events, whether they be professional sporting events, college sporting events, high school, there's Colin Kopenick. No matter how many tweets Trump sends out, it really doesn't matter. And 100,000 or 200,000 say that they are not going to buy the product. They don't matter because more people will now buy the Nike products, including the one at this mic, who doesn't particularly care for that symbol. But it is symbolic in that we support people that support us, although it's not for the reason that we would think. They're not in the social justice business. But now they put themselves in the social justice business, whether or not they wanted to or not. They felt the time has come, and the future of their advertisement, they feature LeBron James, etc. And LeBron is one that DJ Trump attacked, along with the senior representative from Compton, Ms. Waters, of having low IQs. Now, he hasn't, as far as I know, administered any IQ test to any of those individuals, nor do we have the results of any IQ test that DJ Trump has taken, and there are 200 different ones out there. So those kinds of things, the rhetoric is there, but we're now moving to more concrete facts. The alternative facts are beginning to disappear. Lupin Presse is beginning to go back in the drawer. The press is now starting to emerge from some of its darkness, not completely, obviously. But the storyline will be how effective DJ Trump will be in his next 2 years as he goes into lame duck status. A president in lame duck status becomes less effective in the first instance. Then normally the hard work is done the first 2 years. But there's still a budget to be passed in September. Will he be able to do this? Or are they going to have to, as they say, willy-nilly into 2019? And the problem with 2019-2020, the economy itself changes because of demographic things and various other things. GDP will not be as high as it is at the present time. All the models say this, and you have to understand the extraordinary effort of DJ Trump. Massive tax cuts not seen in the history of the U.S. And at the same time, various other items, such as the market. We have these now $1 trillion adventures, we'll call them, at Amazon and now at Google. But we have these stock buybacks, etc. The employment situation itself, whereas low by historic standards, is beginning to wane. Consumer confidence is not necessarily what it was, and it will only go down as more consumers are cash strapped and start to realize this party is over, or is becoming to be over very, very quickly. So these are some of the things that people have to look at. Let's let me just look at our time here. Oh, we're okay. And go to Oops. The polling, and then we'll do the sports. Well, this is Colin Kopanek's commercial. Incidentally, go to his Twitter account, Colin Kopanek. You'll find the commercial. It's a heartwarming commercial there. Very well done. And the voice of Mr. Kopanek himself. We've already talked about the deal where Colin Kopanek draws cheers and pitches of burning shoes. I mean, burning shoes they want. But this is the latest polling out on Wednesday. We have an NBC Marxist University poll. This is Donnelly in the state of Indiana. And Bream, I think it is, yeah. Donnelly, according to this, is ahead by 6 points. And then we have the Florida Senate race. Scott and Nelson tied up. How it will affect, this is Quinnipiac poll. And then we have on the ratings of DJ Trump, the YouGov people have him at 43, and Reuters has him at 42, and Rasmussen down from what is 49 or 50, he's at 44, disapproval at 54. And a generic ballot from the Rasmussen people, Democrats up by 4, from the Reuters, Democrats up by 9, from YouGov up by 5. That was on Wednesday. On a Thursday, we also out of the state of Missouri. This is the NBC Marxist poll between Hockley and Claire McCaskill, tied up 47-47. Out of Florida, this is Gravis. They are tied there 47-47, Bill Nelson and Scott. And the governor's race, they have Gillum ahead by 2. This is Gravis, Gillum, Andrew Gillum over DeSantis. Well, that's in the margin here. And Quinnipiac has Gillum up by 3. Still in the margin here. And generic ballot here, probably an outliner. The ABC News, Washington Post has the Democrats up by 14. And the USA Today Suffolk poll has the Democrats up by 11. So we go back to Monday. Gallup has DJ Trump at 41. The Emerson polling out of Boston has DJ Trump at 38. And the generic ballot has the Democrats, this is from Emerson, Democrats up by 13. And of course, if we go back to Saturday, the Business Daily had DJ Trump at 36. And the generic ballot at 11. So we'll look at all these on a Friday Jobber, which will be on WBRN and radio, and the Boston Red Network will be on Friday morning. So we'll look more at that one. Let's now go to college football, and these are just some that are coming up. We have TCU at SMU. That'll be on Friday night. We have New Mexico at number 5, looks like Wisconsin. That'll be on Saturday. We have Mississippi State at Kansas State. It'll be 12 noon game. Western Michigan and Michigan. Michigan is ranked 21. That'll be a noon game. Also UCLA and number 6 Oklahoma at 1 o'clock. William and Mary and Virginia Tech at 2 o'clock. And Portland State and the Oregon Ducks and 2. These are all Eastern times, incidentally. Arkansas State and number 1 Alabama. People will be tuned into that one. I don't think it'll be much of a game. Georgia and South Carolina. Rutgers and Ohio State. Ellie Bill Graham's alma mater, used to be our music director here. Ball State and Notre Dame. And North Dakota and the Huskies of Washington out of Seattle. Youngstown State and West Virginia, that would be like a 6 o'clock game, evening game. South Carolina and UCF. Savannah State and the Hurricanes. Clemson and Texas A&M. Southeastern Louisiana and LSU. Alabama State and Auburn. Kentucky and Florida. Penn State and Pittsburgh. make sure they haven't changed anything on us. No, these are all on Saturday. UConn and Boise State, and finally Michigan State and Arizona State at 10:45. That'll be, of course, played on the West Coast. Now to the baseball scores, all important baseball scores from Wednesday night. The Sox were in Atlanta. Red Sox 9-8 in that contest. The Sox had 11 hits, no error, and Atlanta 10 hits and 2 errors. The Royals were in Cleveland 3-1. The Cardinals were in Washington, D.C., 7-6 was the score. The Cards had 15 hits, 2 errors, and the Nationals actually had 16 hits and no errors. I don't know why they put that in the light there, anyway. The Reds and Pirates in Pittsburgh, 3-2 was the score there. And the Rays and Blue Jays. Blue Jays 10-3 over the Rays. They were in Toronto, incidentally. The Phillies and Marlins in Florida. Marlins 2-1. The Mets and Dodgers in Los Angeles. Mets pull the game off 7-3. Mr. Rizzo. Rizzo was the loser there. Cubbies and Brewers in Milwaukee. Game we tuned into. The Cubbies pulled it out 6-4. The Angels and Rangers in Texas, it was all Angels 9-3. The Tigers and White Sox on the south side of Chicago, it was the Tigers 10-2. The Twins and Astros in Houston, it was the Astros 9-1. The Giants and Rockies in Denver, Rockies 5-3. Giants are going nowhere, so the Rockies are trying to go somewhere. The Yankees and Athletics in Oakland. Oakland's been playing it tough. 8-2 Athletics. And finally, the Orioles and Mariners out in Seattle. Another team is trying to stay in the race. 5-2 Mariners. So the sports situation is shaping up as we move down less than 30 games, around, 25 games or so. The final month of September, a lot of excitement going on here. And of course, we're covering college ball, college football here also. And we have a little NFL action, I would suppose. Not exactly NFL, but a little bit of action there. Let me just finish this up. I almost forgot this. This is from the Atlantic Age. I put this up. We're watching an anti-democratic coup unfold. This is by David Graham. Acts of sabotage against the president are precarious to the American system of government. They are not self-serving. They are also, self-serving. A picture of Trump trying to get to Air Force One. The title of Bob Woodward's new book, Fear, contains a multitude of meanings. For one thing, it describes the attitude of many of President Trump's own aides towards his judgment. It's not just that sources are willing to tell Woodward damaging stories about Trump. The most stunning examples are those where his top aides reportedly followed his will. Even more stunning is an anonymous, of which we read earlier, written by a purported senior official in the Trump administration. The writer says that senior Trump officials are working diligently from within to frustrate parts of his agenda and his worst inclinations. I would know I'm one of those, the official added. We believe that our duty is to country, and the president continues to act in a manner that is detrimental to the health of our republic. The op-ed is so bizarre that it is tempting to dismiss it as fantasy, akin to the obvious bogus Twitter account that flourished early in the administration, claiming to be by saboteurs from within the White House. While the Time has likely done its homework, expect the president to question the veracity of the source. Yet, what the anonymous official says adds up closely with accounts in Woodward's book, and in which officials steal documents, act on their own, and simply disregard orders from the president. If you believe that Trump does not have the judgment or temperament for the office, not a difficult conclusion to draw, this is a win of sorts. Yet the actions described in the book and in the op-ed are extremely worrying, and the account to a soft coup, I'll get it right in a minute, given that one of Trump's great flaws is that he has a little regard for the rule of law. It's hard to cheer on a cabinet members and others openly throwing Trump's directives, giving unelected officials effective veto power over an elected president. Like Vietnam generals, they are destroying the village in order to save it. As is so often the case in the Trump administration, both the alternatives are awful to consider. In a prologue to Woodward's book obtained by The Atlantic, the economic advisor Gary Cohn, if you remember him, conspired to swipe a letter from the president's desk terminating the United States Korea Free Trade Agreement. Cohn considered it a danger to national security, so he grabbed it. I stole it off his desk and told an associate, according to Woodward. I wouldn't have let him see it. He never is going to see that document. Gotta protect the country. When it became clear that other options, other copies of the letter are floating around, Staff Secretary Rob Portman snapped those up too. He's no longer around. Trump never noticed, and the letter wasn't signed. In another instance, Woodward describes Trump reportedly reached to a chemical to a chemical strike by the Assad regime in Syria by telling Defense Secretary Mad Dog Mattis, "Let's F killing him. Let's go in and let's kill the F lot of them." Yet Mathis said he would get right on it. He hung up the phone. "We're not going to do any of that," he told a senior aide. "We're going to be much more measured." In the immediate circumstance, Mathis alleged refused to obey an order that was almost certain for the best. Trump was reportedly ordering a massive military strike and targeted decapitation of government with no forethought, no strategic plan, In the long term, however, it's unsustainable for the Secretary of Defense to decide which orders from the president he's willing to obey and which he is not. This is a road to chaos. There are other similar examples throughout Woodward's book. Woodward's prose and style, coziness with the sources, have been subject to criticism. He's widely regarded as a meritorious and reliable reporter. Senator Graham reportedly felt that Joseph Danford, the chair of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, was installing a request from Trump for a plan to attack North Korea. When Trump ordered the Department of Defense to revise its acceptance of transgender troops over the Secretary's objection, Mad Dog Mathis told an aide, Steve Bannon, that Mathis would try to reverse the order because the President's directive was so vague. The Pentagon was able to effectively freeze the action for months, ultimately landing on a version that gave Mathis leeway out of its implementation. Woodward writes that then the National Security Advisor, was H.R. McMaster's, believes Mathis and then Secretary Tillerson had concluded that the President and the White House were crazy. As a result, they sought to implement and even formulate policy on their own without interference or the involvement from McMaster's, let alone the President. McMaster's worked by a different protocol drilled in him by the military, which holds civilian rule as sacrosanct. He often disagreed with the president, fought hard on his own views, But once Trump made his mind up, McMaster's job to execute the order. There's at least one historical occurrence in which a previous cabinet member was ready to sabotage the president this way. This was Defense Secretary James Schlesinger, worried by Nixon's heavy drinking, instructed generals not to launch any strikes without his say-so, effectively granting himself veto power of the president. There's no evidence he ever actually used that veto. The scale of an apparent resistance to Trump, is so much grander that Schlesinger's failsafe, even if it was limited only to what we already know, would seem unlikely. While the president has railed against the deep state of liberal bureaucrats, throwing his administration, reality is much stranger. The saboteurs of the president's own appointees and close aides. Apologists for figures like Meadow Memphis and Chief of Staff Kelly have argued for whatever compromises they made by being in the administration, they are serving and protecting the country's best interest by remaining there, insofar as they are able to talk the president out of his worst impulses. The press secretary Sarah Sanders blasts the op-ed's statement, saying the individual behind the piece has chosen to deceive rather than to support the duly elected president of the United States. He is not putting country first, but putting himself or his ego ahead of the will of the American people. This coward should do the right thing and resign. Saying what you will about the wisdom of the voters, but it is the bedrock of the nation, and Trump is the duly elected president. Cabinet members are at least confirmed by the Senate, but they are still unelected officials, like Cohen and Porter, are subject to even less scrutiny. They are appointed directly to their posts, recognizing the blind that a top official serving in an unfit president could face. The nation in 1967 amended the Constitution to provide for removal of a president who is unable to discharge the powers and duties of his office. The 25th Amendment creates a lawful path for top government officials who believe the president cannot serve, work to remove him rather than disobey his orders. According to the anonymous senior official with the Times, the idea had been discussed. This is astonishingly short-sighted. The writer and anyone who thinks that this way overlooks a major flaw. Any situation in which an unelected official is sabotaging the president through a soft coup is always a constitutional critic, as my colleague David Fromm writes. Not only are these acts of sabotage legally precarious, the leaks out are self-serving. Woodward does not reveal his sources, either in general or in specific instances, but a read of the book strongly suggests that Porter and Cohen, amongst those who spoke to him, by spreading the word, they stood up to the president behind closed doors. These figures hoped to burnish their reputations and distance themselves from the stain of the Trump presidency. Leaves on every one its touch, and in doing so they fingered themselves in another questionable pursuit. If the price of defending democracy and the rule of law is to destroy the both, the price is too high. David Graham is a staff writer at The Atlantic and covers politics and global news. Interesting read here, but in itself, this article could be stated as self-serving itself. Obviously, more will come of it. On the 6th of September, 2018, Monkey Business, The Inside Job.